Here's the story of how George Santos became the most prolific liar ever elected to Congress, and how it's not going to end well for him. George Santos is the congressman for New York's 3rd District, which encompasses parts of eastern Queens and northwest Long Island. I used to live there. The only lie I routinely heard in the district was calling it an easy commute to Manhattan. Since the redistricting in 2012, District 3 has been represented by Democrats, who commonly won elections by 10 to 20 points. In 2020, a little-known political failure named George Santos got his ass handed to him while running for Congress, losing by 12.5 points. Why do I call a sitting congressman a political failure? Because at the time, he very much was. Santos used to go by the name Anthony DeVolder, but went by George Santos when he turned his eye toward politics in 2019. It is unclear whether the name change was a cheesy attempt to highlight his Brazilian heritage, or to make it more difficult for voters to Google his criminal past. I'll get to the criminal past part in a bit. First, Santos tried to run for the Queens County Republican Committee, and he couldn't even get enough signatures to qualify for the ballot. Then, Santos tried to organize a pro-Trump rally in Buffalo, which also failed, when other members questioned why Santos needed $20,000 for the effort. The group raised just $645 and didn't even hold the rally, because George Santos is a liar and a failure. So, what changed? How did a MAGA liar and failure get elected to Congress in a Democratic district with a whole bunch of mysterious money? During the 2022 election cycle, Santos personally lent his campaign $700,000, which is pretty hard to do when you've spent your entire life in debt. Settle in, because this is quite the paper trail. In 2014, Santos was evicted from a two-bedroom apartment in Jackson Heights, Queens, which is one of the lowest-cost neighborhoods in the borough. During the eviction hearing, Santos begged to get let back into his apartment to feed his fish. Fish which, according to multiple roommates, didn't exist. Because George Santos is a liar and a failure. Oh, and it was also illegal for Santos to have that many roommates in a two-bedroom apartment. Over the next 3 years, Santos was habitually delinquent, being evicted twice more, while lying about rent checks getting lost in the mail and other such nonsense. And I want to be clear, my problem with Santos is not that he couldn't pay his rent. I also grew up poor in Queens. My point here is to establish that Santos could not have possibly had $700,000 to lend to his campaign, and that he is a habitual liar. Santos is also a massive hypocrite, as he had to apply for public assistance to pay his rent. And just a few years later, he decried people who needed to apply for public assistance to pay their rent, while also fraudulently claiming that he owned 13 properties. He does not, and he never has. Santos hypocritically said the following.
Youth today is more so interested in what they can get for free versus how hard they can work for something and accomplish it.
Santos said that on his public access show, which lasted, let me check my notes, one episode, because Santos is a liar and a failure. In the midst of all of these Big Apple evictions, Santos somehow voted in another state. In 2016, just 5 days after one of Santos's New York evictions, he registered to vote in Florida. He then voted there. And 6 days after Santos voted in Florida, he again registered in New York. Is your head spinning yet? Well, buckle up. In 2020, Santos was earning $55,000 a year from a company called Linkbridge Investors. And then, somehow, Santos began working for Harbor City Capital, where he told prospective clients that he invested $4 million of his own money. How could someone making $55,000 a year and constantly being evicted have $4 million of his own money to invest? Maybe he saved up from never paying rent. Or, just maybe, George Santos is a liar and a failure. Harbor was an investment firm that the SEC sued shortly after they hired Santos. Why did the SEC sue them? Because their business plan was a $17 million Ponzi scheme. Even before Santos was hired, Harbor was already banned from operations in Alabama for defrauding Alabamers. Alabamites? Alabamerammerins? Alabamerammers? For defrauding people living in Alabama. When Alabama bans a company, you know something is really, really wrong. Despite Santos's denial to this day, he obviously knew he was scamming people. He personally sent fraudulent letters with fake bank executive signatures on them. He lied about which company's executives he was friends with. And he lied about investing his own money. Santos eventually lost that job, because the job no longer existed when the company's assets were frozen. Of course, Santos said otherwise. Santos lied and said that he had to leave Harbor because of a conflict of interest with his political ambitions, because George Santos is a liar and a failure. After Harbor's assets were frozen by the government, Santos started his own investment firm called the DeVolder Organization. Santos has said that it was a family business that managed over $80 million worth of assets. And if you believe that, you probably need to restart this video and watch it again. Santos's company was allegedly based in New York, but it registered in Florida. The company was dissolved less than a year and a half after it was formed, for failing to file annual reports. Santos listed zero clients on financial disclosure forms. And Dun & Bradstreet very much disagreed with Santos's $80 million figure, estimating the company's revenue at slightly lower, $50,000. Because George Santos is a liar and a failure. But it gets so much worse. After being elected, Santos re-registered the company in Florida with himself as the registered agent. And that is absolutely illegal. If Santos lives in Florida, he cannot be a congressman in New York. If Santos lives in New York, he can't be the registered agent of a Florida company. The company's mailing address is clear fraud. A Florida apartment that Santos does not live in. That apartment is formerly owned by the CTO of, you guessed it, Harbor City Capital. But let's get back to Santos's first attempt at Congress in 2020. After Santos got his butt kicked in that election, he refused to accept it. Santos spoke at one of those Stop the Steal rallies on January 5th, where he said both he and Donald Trump had elections stolen from them. And then, after the events of January 6th, Santos somehow denied that he believed the election was stolen. I can just imagine it. I had that belief in a very different time in my life. Yesterday. After Santos's embarrassing and fraud-filled loss in 2020, he ran again in 2022. When he did, Santos did not file the personal disclosure form until it was long overdue, lied about Trump endorsing him, and, despite being asked by major Republican donors, refused to share his resume with them. Santos's own campaign conducted a vulnerability study on him, and when they found out the tons of bull he'd been peddling, they tried to get him to drop out of the race. Let me say that again. Santos's own campaign staff tried to get him to drop out of the race. Santos found a solution to that. He hired a different campaign staff. When Republican challengers arose, Santos and his PAC donated almost $200,000 to the county Republican committee, which then endorsed him. Other challengers were subsequently encouraged to run for other offices. Santos definitely benefited from the mysterious money that poured into his campaign, which I'll discuss in a little bit. But Santos was also the beneficiary of just some plain old good luck. The Democratic incumbent decided last minute not to run. There was higher than average Republican turnout due to the hotly contested governor race, and the redistricted map that would slightly favor Democrats was thrown out by a court. All of that combined, but mostly the mysterious money, got Santos elected. And when he was elected, things only got worse. But first, that criminal past I promised you. In 2008, then 20-year-old George Santos did something reprehensible. He stole checks from a man his mother was caring for. This is not alleged. Santos admitted to this in writing and was charged with check fraud in 2010. Unfortunately, the case was archived when Brazilian authorities couldn't locate Santos after he moved to New York. Fortunately, now that he's a congressman, they know exactly where he is. And Brazil is reviving the charges. And despite previously admitting to the theft in writing, Santos now denies it. Because George Santos is a liar and a failure. In 2015, an ex-boyfriend accused Santos of stealing and pawning his cell phone. Two former roommates have accused Santos of stealing clothing and furniture. Also in 2015, a judge ruled that Santos owed a former roommate $5,000. But Santos has not paid back any of that money. In 2016, Santos was in court again, this time for owing a landlord over $2,000 in rent. Santos told the court that he was robbed on his way to pay the landlord. And he said that for some reason the police were unable to take down his report. In 2017, another judge ruled that Santos owed a different landlord $12,000, which he still has not paid back, because George Santos is a liar and a failure. But it's not all petty theft and rent delinquency. It is amazing that Santos is even allowed in a car after receiving over 40 tickets and citations. He still owes New York $2,100 in unpaid tickets, and Florida another $1,300. Florida even suspended his license. And this is not in the distant past either. In the 5 months since Santos has been elected, he has already racked up 5 speeding tickets, 4 of which were in school zones. And that's the small stuff. Despite being openly gay and not bisexual, Santos married a woman, who subsequently got her green card and then citizenship. During this time, the two lived in separate places. Meanwhile, Santos had multiple boyfriends. He proposed to a man, and he referred to another man as his husband. Santos ran a bogus animal rescue charity that was never registered with the state or the IRS as a nonprofit. It was never even registered as a rescue organization. In 2017, Santos was charged with theft in Pennsylvania for writing bad checks to breeders. Since then, he's been accused of doing the same thing by 3 other breeders. Speaking of dogs, the FBI is currently investigating Santos for raising $3,000 on GoFundMe for a veteran's dog with cancer. And then not giving the veteran the money. The dog was never operated on and died shortly after. and Santos has been banned from using the GoFundMe platform. So Santos stole checks from someone in his mother's care, and stole a GoFundMe from a veteran's dying dog. And those aren't close to the worst things that he's done. Last month, a prospective staffer accused Santos of tricking him into working for free while his paperwork was allegedly still being processed, and also sexually assaulting him. And this isn't even everything. These are just the highlights, because I still need time to cover Santos's absolute garbage biography. Santos has claimed to be the victim of vandalism and two muggings, all of which have no police reports and no corroborating evidence. Santos has claimed that he's had both knees replaced, immunodeficiency, chronic bronchitis, and a brain tumor, all of which have no accompanying medical records and no corroborating evidence. Santos has even claimed that he and his family have worked on behalf of sick children born with epidermolysis bullosa, a story which he has since changed after an investigation found, you guessed it, no supporting financial records and no corroborating evidence. Are you starting to notice a pattern? Santos was running in a district with a large Jewish population against a Jewish opponent. So he claimed that his grandparents were Holocaust survivors from Ukraine and Belgium. Nope, they were not Jewish and they were born in Brazil. Santos later walked back his claims of being Jewish, saying that he was Catholic and that he meant Jew-ish. Yeah, that's a real thing an adult said seriously. The Catholic Jewish Santos also claimed to be biracial because his father's from Angola, despite there being no evidence of that either. Santos's campaign website talked about his mother and called her the first female executive at a major financial institution. The website also said that she worked in the South Tower of the World Trade Center during 9/11 and died a few years later after surviving the tragedy. That's weird, because Santos's mother was a home care nurse who spoke little to no English. She wasn't in the country during 9/11, and she died in 2016. When she did, Santos, who remember said he was Jewish, got his church to raise a collection for her funeral, and I'm sure he didn't keep any of that money himself. Santos said he attended New York's prestigious Horace Mann Prep School, but the school disagrees. Santos said he attended undergrad at Baruch, but the school disagrees. Santos said he received an MBA from NYU, but the school disagrees. According to past roommates, colleagues, and prospective donors, Santos has claimed one hell of a work history. It includes him being a Brazilian journalist, a model during New York's Fashion Week, and a producer for Spider-Man Turn Off the Dark. And there is zero evidence that any of that is true. George or Anthony or whatever your name is, if you're gonna claim to produce a Broadway musical, at least pick a good one. Santos's most constant lies are about his financial history. Santos has repeatedly said that he has worked for both Citigroup and Goldman Sachs, calling himself a seasoned Wall Street financier and investor. Santos even went on podcasts to talk about a conference he attended and the principled stand he took while he was there. Citigroup, Goldman, and the conference organizer have all shown proof that Santos never worked for them, and also didn't attend the conference. Not only is it easy to verify that Santos was a call center rep for Dish Network at the time, but the division that Santos claimed he worked for at Citigroup didn't even exist yet, because George Santos is a liar and a failure. The most offensive lie about George Santos's work history is that he lost 4 employees to the Pulse nightclub shooting. Yes, this horrible person stole from a man in his mother's care, and a veteran with a sick dog, and has also tried to capitalize on the Pulse nightclub shooting, 9/11, and the Holocaust. And speaking of capitalizing, let's talk about the mysterious money behind this fraudulent ghoul. In 2020, Santos listed a net worth of $5,000 and an income of $50,000 from Harbor. Somehow, just 2 years later, his net worth was listed at $11 million, including $5 million in personal bank accounts and a $1 million condo in Rio. Santos didn't list owning any property in the US, despite also saying that he owned 13 properties. Two of those non-existent, non-listed properties included mansions on Long Island, one of which Santos said he was selling for $10 million. Which is weird, because that property was owned by someone else, and only worth $2 million. Santos did report the car loan on his Nissan, though. The $700,000 that Santos allegedly lent his own campaign is not the only dollar amount that is as fishy as, well, his non-existent fish. Santos's campaign listed several of his relatives, who worked either low-paying jobs or no jobs at all, donating up to $45,000. Those relatives have denied ever donating. Some actual donors have been listed at donating thousands more dollars than they did, and $30,000 of his donations came from people whose addresses or names were entirely fabricated. And all that fake money had to come from somewhere. Santos's fundraising campaign has been credibly accused of everything, from credit cards, to fake PACs, to one staffer raising money by pretending to be Kevin McCarthy's chief of staff. There are simply too many discrepancies to list. But Santos's fraudulent fundraising included clear legal violations, like a donation from someone who is not a US citizen, and whose brother Santos just happened to appoint to his staff. Santos's spending is just as suspect. Santos's campaign allegedly spent $40,000 in airfare, flying all over the country, despite running in a district that is a few miles wide. Santos listed well over 1,000 unitemized expenses of $199.99. That's a pretty coincidental dollar amount, considering campaign law requires you to itemize expenses $200 or more. The FEC sent Santos over 20 letters in regards to discrepancies on his financial reporting. So why has the FEC not actually done anything? Because the Justice Department has asked them not to, as they conduct their own criminal investigation. I once knew someone a lot like George Santos. Many years ago, I worked with someone who name-dropped so often that a few of the more frustrated staff got together to ask him which celebrities he knew. After rattling off a bunch of nonsensically famous names, the guy actually said, "Tell me who you like, and I'll tell you how I know them." He was just 16 years old at the time. I don't have the psychological background to correctly diagnose George Santos or Anthony DeVolder or whatever other aliases he uses. What I do know is that George Santos spent most of his life desperately trying to be seen as a success. Santos wants to be seen as a model, a scholar, a Wall Street prodigy, a real estate mogul, a philanthropist, and a hero. But George Santos has never been and will never be any of that. The two things that George Santos will always be are a liar and a failure. And Santos has stolen from enough people for long enough that he will not be able to escape justice forever. This will likely be his only term in Congress, if he's even able to complete it. And once he is no longer in a position to help them, whoever mysteriously funded George Santos's campaign will not stand in the way of his arrest. Perhaps authorities will let him out of prison just long enough to feed his fish. I'm Steve Hofstetter, and this was for the smart people. Thanks for watching and sharing this video. And thank you for following me on YouTube, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, and everything else. If you want to watch videos like this before anyone else, check out patreon.com/Steve Hofstetter and come to a live show. I am touring just about everywhere. You can get tickets and see where all my shows are at stevehofstetter.com. Thanks for watching.